Hello, this is Kevin Edgington with Bangard Inc. And today's webinar is basically on creating estimates and performing takeoff. So as I mentioned earlier, I pretty much got everyone on open mics. The session is being recorded, so that way you can get playbacks of the recordings and so forth they've been sending out for the attendees and so forth. So don't hesitate to ask questions as we go through. So, you know, if you want to just speak out the questions, great. If you want to throw them in the chat, I'm trying to monitor the chat window and question and answer screen also, so that way if there's any questions, just go ahead and we'll try to work them in as we go through the content and so forth. So the main thing I was thinking of for today was I'm kind of looking at these series right now, it's just kind of ramping things up, and we are also looking for any type of feedback on additional ones. So I've got like my next new 2 months planned out and so forth, but I'm really also interested in getting feedback from people. So, you know, when I get to the last screen, it'll have a some of our contact information and things of that nature that we'll talk about. So as you're going through here and thinking of other things, you know, if you want to make note of them and drop myself an email or a coordinator an email of, you know, what other content you'd like to see, you know, whether it's going to be classes like this, or we're also supposed to be doing some about one YouTube video a week for content. You know, so we could possibly get some content that way that could help you, you know, be more efficient with the software or topics and things like that, would greatly be appreciated. So with that being said, today's session is more, last time we talked about just kind of starting the database out, how to build a blank database, how to do a little bit of one-time items and save those one-time items to the database and so forth, just to kind of get the baby steps of walking when somebody has no database at all. So if anyone's interested in that, you know, reach out to us also, because we can get to the recording of that session. And I think that one's actually on YouTube already, also under our YouTube channel. And this one, I'm just kind of thinking about taking it the next step. So now that we've got, you know, at least a database started, there's some things in there. I want to kind of talk more about quick takeoff and item takeoff, using assemblies more efficiently, and things of that nature, models and how models tie into it. And that's probably my next session is assemblies. And I think the one after that, I think was going to talk about models and so forth. So that's kind of where my ramp up, at least to start off with, is. It might even be advanced reporting. I don't remember offhand. So anyway, so this one's going to be creating estimates and one-time items and quick takeoff, item takeoff, assemblies. So let's just go ahead and get it started here. So creating an estimate, you know, depending on your status, I've got some clients with us that, you know, are very new to the software, just kind of getting things going. I've got some that's been using the software for years. So I'm just going to kind of run through some of the important things. I may or may not hit on every single step. So I'm just going to start off with new estimate. Pretty basic. What's the name of the estimate? What database do I want to use? So, you know, if somebody's got multiple databases out there, I could get to the different databases. As we're going through here, this is where I can also set up different branches for how we want to organize our estimates. So over here, there's a browse feature where I could go in and basically tell it, you know, where are these estimates going to be kept. So right now, I basically created me a folder of trash estimates. So when I do my sessions, and I know that I can go back and delete these without any, you know, any efforts on reporting reports that I build or things like that. But I can go in here and actually pick a particular branch, or you might even come in here and create a branch, you know, under there. So I can actually say that this is my, 2020. Maybe I even want to keep today's estimate separate or something of that nature. You know, you can create branches however you want in that way. They're out there, and we'll kind of talk about how to move that around and do some better searches and so forth with that in a little bit. So basic information, you know, all my different cover page information. And in our first session, we kind of went through and talked about a lot of these fields. So I'm not going to dabble with too much of this today, but I am going to at least hit the critical ones. So I'm going to start with this collapse all, and in my mind, some of the critical ones is the crew information. So if your company is utilizing crews, this is critical, because this is how the system knows what labor dollars to actually put in the estimate, or equipment dollars and things of that nature. So I can have one rate for one state and one rate for a different state, or, you know, a different pay scale for a particular job, and it at least allows me to go through and create, you know, what that scale is going to be. So this is probably the most critical bucket, because this is the one that actually can affect the dollars. A lot of this other stuff, you know, if you use it or don't use it, it's more for reporting, it's more for searching, things of that nature. In this database, I don't remember if they use rate tables or not, so I'm going to go ahead and pick one here just to make sure I've got something in there. And then my equipment rate table looks like it's already pre-filled. The other thing that could actually affect your dollars is the city cost index. So most clients don't have city cost indexes set up, but where this comes into probably more play is clients that have like RS means databases. So a lot of people, if they develop the database themselves or so forth, you know, they don't really have it set up, but when I buy RS means, they have the same city cost indexes as the back of the book in there. So I can basically go off and say, yep, I'm building this estimate and it's going to be in, you know, Des Moines, Iowa, and it'll actually adjust all my labor rates for that particular area. The rest of this information is going to be somewhat critical for sorting, finding, reporting, things of that nature. So, you know, if I did want to go ahead and say that this is the plans dated of, 1/1/2020 or whatever the case is, revision A, you know, that maybe that's something I could put on a report or put in a search engine to try to find it. Or maybe I want to say that, you know, at this point in time, there's five addendas or whatever the case is. This will let me go off and, you know, there again, I could put on a report. So I could put at the bottom of a report for a client, you know, this estimate's based on plans dated as of this date or this revision, or there were this many addendas out at this point in time, those type of things. So at that point, I just get my blank spreadsheet. And at this point, I really just kind of want to focus on takeoff and just getting some things out there. So in our last session, we talked a little bit about one-time items and basically where I could just go in and just create something on the fly. So it's not in the database. I need it for this job. So I could go off to one-time items and basically tell it what phase it's going to be under. So if I want to go in and maybe I've got a superintendent that I want to put in there at some special rate than what my database normally is or something of that nature. You know, I can go off and do whatever I need to for that that item, and basically it would then go off and let me create that item right there for that estimate. So one-time items are not in the database. They're basically just for this estimate. They can be saved to the database. So that's where in the last session we kind of talked about, you know, starting it off an estimate that way and saving it back to the database. So that way you could gradually get more and more content in this database to kind of fit what you need. Once I get some of my database established, then I'm probably going to be focusing more on some of the other methods. So quick takeoff is one of those methods. So with quick takeoff, it allows me to look through a list. And as I find content, I can double click on it and drop that content out in my estimate. Pretty basic. So I can come on down through the list and, you know, yep, I need a carpenter foreman, or maybe I need a project manager for this job or whatever the case is. And I can go through there and pick, and I could be putting quantities at the same time. And just kind of keep in mind that a lot of these boxes that pop up, if you move to the heading of the box and just kind of slide them around, you can kind of reposition them. So that's where I kind of like mine off on the right-hand side a little bit, so I can see the descriptions of quantities if I want to quantify things as I'm putting them in and things of that nature. As I look at some of these different sections, I might also come in and start using things like my control key. So if I click once and I'm holding down the control key on my keyboard right now, and let's say I need the phone hookup and electricity and I need a temporary toilet, you know, I can go through there and take whatever lines I need, go to any one of the that I've highlighted. I've let go of my control on my keyboard at the moment, and that way I can just drag and drop. So if I want to move many items over, and they don't necessarily have to be from the same heading, so I could go through there and pick from multiple headings if I needed to. So sometimes that's a little bit faster than picking each one at a time. If I know that I want a block of items, so let's say I went from here and this time I'm holding down my shift key, you know, so that way I can grab a whole block of items at once and drag and drop them out. If I know I want, let's say, what's something else that has a few things in it? Let's say here, so office equipment. So let's say I know my database well enough to know most of this office equipment I want before I ever open it up. So another little trick that you can do that's kind of handy is if you hold down your control key, when you double click on it, everything will automatically be highlighted so you can just drag it out. So those are just some ways of getting content from that database into your estimate, and should be pretty basic at that point. The biggest thing is making sure that, you know, the content that I need is in that database. As I'm looking through this list, there's a lot of hunting and pecking going on. So usually somebody's looking in here, no, that's not what I want, and that's not what I want, and oh yeah, there's that traffic control or whatever the case is, and toss it out. If I double click on a folder, it will shut it. So this can actually be you know, a little bit of a hindrance if I've got all these different folders and so forth. So one thing to keep in mind is on my keyboard, you've got a section there for your left, right, up, down, you know, for the direction of your arrow keys. If I hit my left-hand arrow key, that will actually close a folder. Left-hand arrow key again will close the group. So that way I could use all my arrow keys. Right now I'm just using my arrow key up and down. My right-hand arrow key will also open if I want to. So where this is really handy is some people have sections of divisions of work that have just a lot of different items. So like metal studs is the perfect example that if I scroll down through this list a half a mile long and I say, yep, there's the item I want, you know, it doesn't make sense to scroll all the way to the top to close it. I can just bump my left-hand arrow key and close that folder immediately or bump it again and, you know, head off in some different direction. So kind of keep that in mind. That could be a great navigational tool to let me move around a little bit faster. Within that list, you also have a search, which could be very handy. So that way, if I said something like paint, there's everything in this database with the word paint in it. So that way I could go through there and say, yeah, I was looking for painting some wood trim, or I was looking for painting some exterior work or whatever the case is. So that search can be a nice way of going through and trying to find something instead of, you know, all the hunting and pecking. Depending on how well your database is set up, if I thought about something like a footing, you know, I know the database fairly well. So if I went through this one and said, okay, well, I need to, you know, form a footing or dig a footing or something like that. So maybe I can go off to my excavation and find my footings and, you know, find whatever items that boils down to. Or maybe I find some concrete and find some forming or concrete or wire mesh or rebar or things like that. If I did a search, depending on how your items are set up, this database is kind of nice because everything's kind of started with the prefix of, you know, a footing or a slab or a wall. So, you know, now I can say, oh, I want to excavate by hand. I need some shaping and grading to crumb the bottom of the footing. I need to form this footing. I need some concrete for the footing or whatever the case is. And basically I could just go through that list and pick the items a lot faster. The one challenge with quick takeoff, if you do a lot of quick takeoff, it's how you sort your estimate. So right now I'm looking at this by phase and item, the same way the database is organized. So if I went back and let's say I took off some more general requirements and I took off maybe this assistant superintendent, I don't really know whether that hit my spreadsheet or not, because it's way probably up here at the top of the list, or same thing vice versa. If I went down to, let's see, what am I up to? I'm seeing some of the division nine for finishes. So let's see, I've got some sort of equipment out here. You know, same type of thing. I threw some equipment out there. It's way at the bottom of the list possibly, but I can't see anything. If you do a lot of quick takeoff, you will probably find that looking at your estimate in takeoff order is going to be somewhat helpful, because this sorts the estimate in the order you build it. So that way I could tell there's that kitchen appliances, and there's the assistant superintendent I did, and there's the concrete I did. So the nice thing about this is no matter where I jump, if you notice, it's also going to start scrolling my spreadsheet automatically. So that way, I always like the confirmation that something hit the spreadsheet. So anybody that does a lot of quick takeoff, that's going to be somewhat handy, just so that way you can tell what hit the spreadsheet and get that confirmation right away, instead of stuff being at the top or the bottom or scrolling up or down in the list to try to find content and so forth. Rarely the people use it, but you could. I'm going to go back here and kind of simplify my spreadsheet a little bit more. So I'm going to go back out to my spreadsheet and actually just delete everything out of here. On some items, you could actually go and set up formulas on the items. So if I go down to like my footings here, oops, not rebar, concrete, I know it has a formula on it. If I check this box for inner dimensions, if I have this turned off and I pick an item, it just shows you the spreadsheet. And I could do whatever I want with the quantity. If I have this box checked, if this item has a formula associated with it, it will then come up and ask me questions about that line. So maybe I could say, what is that? That's a footing. So maybe it's 100 foot long, 2.5 foot wide, 12 inches deep. And as soon as I hit OK, it'll basically just come up with a quantity and say, you know, you need just shy of 10 yards concrete. So that could be handy if someone writes formulas. Now, most of the time I find a lot of clients that do quick takeoff is because we don't understand formulas yet, or I don't have time to write the formulas or whatever the case is. So most of the time, if I really know anything at all about writing formulas, I'm probably going to be using assembly takeoff. So a lot of time, most clients, I'm going to probably recommend that to be turned off, because if I didn't write the formula or know someone in our office who went through it, I'm probably better off to, you know, rattle the calculator, come up with a number, and have it drop it in the cell and so forth. And that's pretty much what quick takeoff is about. As you're looking through this list, if I'm looking through it and can't find what I'm looking for, keep in mind that you can right-hand click on an item and say edit item. And if I'm somebody that has database rights, I can actually create new items in the database myself. So in this case here, I can hit add. I can look at my list and say, I got a 10, I got a 20, and I got this crazy, I don't know what that garbage line is, but it's way down there in the numbering scheme. So I'm just gonna go ahead and first start off with saying prefill, so that way it'll mimic the last one I just did. I'm gonna say number 30, so that way mine will just be at the bottom of the list, or at least before this garbage line. And maybe I wanna go ahead and say that this is gonna be maybe I got a different rate for a working superintendent or something of that nature. So, you know, then I could come in here and give it some different rate for some reason. And as soon as I hit OK and accept it, then it's going to actually be in my database and so forth. So that way I can now throw it into an estimate and those type of things. So a lot of time, if my database is not in great shape, or if I find myself doing a lot of one-time items, it's amazing how many clients I work with that do, you know, half of their estimate with one-time items. And my only drawback with that is, you know, everything is different, but to some extent, there's a lot of similarities in most clients' work also. So that's where, really getting some items in there, so that way I'm not having to sit there and type the description and unit of measures and things of that nature. So I can get into more, you know, coming up with the quantities and stuff that is more critical or more something that's going to be where the differences really are, instead of the description and unit of measures. And even if you don't even put any money in for that item, but at least having, you know, a lot of the content there, so I could just drop an item, quantify it, price it if I need to, some of those type of things. Any questions with quick takeoff before we jump to item? So I'm going to go ahead and just clean this out again, and let's look at item takeoff then. So item takeoff is very close to quick takeoff. The main difference with item takeoff is, if I had a whole bunch of content in my spreadsheet already. So let's go back here a second and let's just fill up the screen with a bunch of stuff. So, you know, if I had hundreds of items already in an estimate, sometimes it can be confusing on adding new content. So for an example, some clients might go through and say, okay, here's footing A, here's footing B, here's footing C, or footing 1, 2, and 3, or whatever the case is. So they might have some of the same similar items in their estimate multiple times. So because of that, you know, I might look in there and say, oh, I already see footing forms, or I already see concrete or something of that nature. So that's where some people like item takeoff, because item takeoff almost takes me away from my estimate. So I'm off on this little screen here. So I can sit there and do takeoff down here before it ever gets intertwined with the spreadsheet at all. So if I went back and kind of thought about that footing a little bit, you know, I could come in here and start going down through there and site work. So maybe if I wanted to say that I need to footings by machine. So then I could come in here and quantify things. Now, this is kind of the same game. This is going to try to write formulas, or items could have formulas on it to help me calculate these quantities. In this example, I'm saying, you know, I don't know enough about formulas, so I'm probably not going to trust these unless I've went through them and kind of validated them or tested them. So in this case here, I'm just going to kind of go through and I hit F11 for my calculator. Or I could right click and go to calculator. So maybe I want to say that the footing was, you know, 100 foot long. We're going to basically dig it. Let's say it's 2.5 foot wide for the concrete. So maybe we're going to go ahead and over dig it by, you know, an extra foot on each side. So maybe we're going to say it's going to be 4.5 foot. And let's say that we're going to dig it down about, 3 foot down, or whatever the case is, divide by 27 to get me to yardage. So, you know, if I hit enter, it'll calculate. If I hit enter again, it'll drop it in there. Most people at this point are probably not even using the calculator. Most clients are probably just, you know, if they're doing a lot of this, they're probably just pulling up their construction calculators and rattling numbers through it and so forth, putting in the result of it and so forth for the most part. And as I go down through here, you know, I can pick my forms in and so on and so forth. So you kind of get the idea, you know, it's exactly the same as what I had before. So I can go through there and, you know, maybe I got a couple steps, maybe I got a couple hundred square foot of surface area of my forms and so forth. So this will just let me go through there and pick whatever items. So just like Quick Takeoff, but the nice thing about this is I'm not being overwhelmed by the visual of all that other, you know, hundreds of items in that estimate. I can sit back and look at these three items and say, oh shoot, I forgot to put a concrete in this, so I forgot to put my rebar in yet, or whatever the case is. So it's very visual that I can sit back and kind of see what I've got so far without being overwhelmed with all the other stuff I might have in the spreadsheet. The other benefit that this resides in is, I'm going to just throw a couple more items out here for the heck of it, and I am going to just take these quantities out for a moment. And let's say that I also have, maybe I need some rebar for that footing. And maybe I need some concrete for the footing. So maybe that's a good start. If you keep in mind, you can still do the same thing with the open and close arrows and using control and shift, and everything we talked about with Quick Takeoff is similar there. If I right-hand click, you can still do the search. So that way, if I want to look for the footing, you know, same type of searchability. The only trick is you got to remember the right click to be able to get to it. Now, one of the things that I'm also very surprised about when I look at estimators and how they build estimates is a lot of people go through and do a lot of Quick Takeoff, and they pick very similar items on a job by job basis. So one other little secret here that I don't know how many people really know or not is, if I pick these items, and like I said, you could go through here and quantify them, you may leave them blank. If I go through there and pick these items and I look at that list and say, that's something I would do again, I could actually save that content back to the database to at least have that list of items. Because, you know, it didn't take me that long to pick those five items. But, you know, by the time I went to Division 2 for some digging and Division, 3 for some rebar and forming, or heaven forbid it was a slab that maybe has some Division 7 for vapor barrier, you know, some of these things that we take off might have different items in different areas. So that's a lot of jumping around to find the content. This little button stands for save as an assembly. So it's always kind of interesting if I ask somebody, it's like, why don't we do a lot of assembly takeoff? And, you know, the most common response is, they just take too long. You know, I don't have a month to write that perfect assembly or something of that nature. And there again, totally agree. There's a lot of things that we have to kind of do as we're doing takeoff that maybe it takes 2 seconds longer, but then the next time, you know, I kind of reap the benefit. Or then if I can go back to this assembly and add some formulas to it or whatever the case is. So I'm going to hit the save as assembly. That will actually let me create an assembly. So it's already put all these items all into assembly. All I have to do is figure out how I want to code it. Now with these assemblies, you have a choice of one time or database. So a one time assembly would just be for this estimate. So even somebody that says, well, I work at a company and shoot, they don't give me enough rights to do anything in the database, I could still create my own one time, and that way they would be in this estimate. So once I build that footing once, can I use that same group of items over and over and over? Now, I also work with a couple clients that the estimator doesn't have rights to actually go off and add stuff to the database, but I do have a couple that they've went through and done some one-time assemblies and actually have saved that estimate as a template, deleted all the line items out of it, so when they start new estimates, they can copy it, so that way they can at least start with all their one-time assemblies that they know that they, you know, have built and have mastered, even though they don't have database rights, but they've kind of saved their own catalog of, hey, here's what I do at a regular basis. I'm going to save this to make it more reusable. Or for those of us that have database rights, if it's something else that someone else in the office can also benefit from and I want to use it on multiple jobs, you know, that's where database makes perfect sense. So in this case, I'm going to pull up a list and kind of get an idea of what's in my database because I don't remember right offhand. So if I take a look at my database right now, it looks like they've kind of broke things out by some of the different divisions roughly. So because I don't like to scroll down very far in the list, it looks like if I made one called 00, mine would be at the top of the list. I'm going to go ahead and close this down, and I'm going to go in and say 00 dash, and I'm going to just call that number 10, for example. And I'm just going to say that that has something to do with it. And I could actually call it footing or slab or whatever the case is. Most of the time, I like to use numbers more because I like to dictate the order. I don't like things going in alphabetical order because, you know, if you said something like a footing, a slab, an exterior wall, you know, an exterior wall, E would show up before my footing. So that would kind of mess up my order of process if I wanted to kind of set it in. No, we do our footings first, then we come back and do the slab, or then we put a wall on top of the footing, or, you know, however your method of your madness is how you like to take something off. A lot of time numbers are easier to kind of dictate that order. If you also notice, I went with 10, 20, 30, 40. It gives me nine numbers in between to sneak other things in when I, oh shoot, I really like this above that one, and you know, not getting in a jam and getting myself pinched into a corner for numbers and so forth. So I'm going to call that a footing, and we'll come back and use this in a little bit. What I'm also going to do in this one is, because I don't know anything about formulas and a lot of these items that I picked had formulas on them, I'm also going to go down and just say use factor. And all use factor does is it just knocks out this calculation that I have in here. So I'm just going to kind of breeze down through here and just knock all those formulas out, so that way no one accidentally uses those formulas, since I don't necessarily know at this point in time what those calculations do yet. So I'm going to say close here, and that's really what kind of quick takeoff looks like. So I could come down through, and let's just go and manually do this one. So let's say I got 97 yards there, and let's say that I've got a couple steps in it, and I've got a couple hundred square foot of surface area, and maybe I've got a couple hundred lino foot of rebar, and I've got a few yards of concrete or whatever. So I could quantify them. I could leave the quantities blank. Doesn't matter. Once I say okay, when I close it up and actually look at it, my estimate by takeoff order, you know, there's all that garbage that I had in there, and there's a handful of items that I just added, all quantified and priced out and so forth at this point. So those are basically where we've just kind of went through and been able to pick items and get them into the spreadsheet and get them quantified and so forth. And that's really what item takeoff is about, is just a little different way of getting it in there. Questions with item takeoff before we jump into assemblies? So assemblies are basically twofold. So some assemblies are like what we just built. We just built that footing one that had no formulas associated with it. And one of the things that always mystifies me is, you know, some assemblies don't get any more complicated than that. When you think about a lot of clients, when they look at like general conditions, there's not a bunch of fancy calculations for general conditions. Maybe if I get into like specialty items, you know, how many soap dispensers, how many trash cans, how many mirrors, whatever the case is, you know, there's not a bunch of fancy calculations. If you had a good assembly that had all your specialty items in one assembly, it'd be a lot easier to open it up and just ding, ding, ding right down through the list as you're quantifying components. So as we go through there, that's one of the reasons why I think assemblies are just so critical, because that way you could just build a list of, you know, here's all the common things I use or things I want at least to force someone to think about. And it didn't really take me much longer to build than just doing the takeoff initially. If I take a look at my database at the moment, I am going to take one detour. I'm going to take a look at assemblies here. And there's that assembly I just built. And one of the things I don't like about this assembly I just built is, if I pull up a list, there's a heading here called group not found, because I picked a number that was before general condition. So I am going to add one more assembly to the database, just so that way I've got my own group. And this is not necessarily required, but I want to keep all mine separate here. So I'm going to say zero. Is that zero, zero? I already forgot. Zero, zero, yeah. So we're going to say 00 dash. Whatever I want to call it. And I'm going to call this a group. So that way, all that does is it basically makes it where when I pull up a list, I could see whatever title I give it, and then I could see all my assemblies that I've created, you know, at that point. And typically you'd want to, you know, keep them in some sort of spec sections or type of work, or however you're going to organize your assemblies and things like that. I'm just kind of keeping mine off the top to make them easier to find for this case, so I can clean them up. So now when I go back to assembly takeoff, there's that section I just had. There's that footing. Now, what I'm also going to do is I am going to back up, and we're going to create one more one-time assembly. So I'm going to go in here, and I don't really care. Let's just pick some things. So let's say I got some demolition to do and demo in here, and then maybe we're going to go off and, I don't know, do some forming or whatever the case is and whatever. So you've got some sort of list of items picked of whatever you're using. And if there, again, if you decide that that's going to be something common, that maybe this list is going to be just more for this job. I've got, you know, I just did all the detail for what makes up a particular wall, and they've got that same wall type in many floors or rooms, or some reason I'm breaking it off. So same type of thing. I could come in here, say save as assembly. This time I'm going to do a one-time assembly, so you can see where that shows up differently. And I'm just going to, you know, you could stick with the same numbers if you wanted to. I'm just going to go ahead and, you know, give it a word, just so we can see where that shows up. So I'm going to say cancel there. So those, when I go to assembly takeoff, not item takeoff, semi takeoff. Those will show up with the name of your estimate at the top. So there was the name of my estimate that I'm working on, estimate 7, and there's all the one-time assemblies for this estimate. So that's kind of what one-time assemblies look like. If you do create any an estimate, they basically show up at the top as whatever that division is, or whatever that estimate name is. So basically, there's the one I saved to the database. There's the one I actually saved to just this particular estimate, and same type. So if I open it up, you know, anything that I quantify goes back to my spreadsheet. Anything that I skip does not. So maybe in this case here, I got all this demo and some of this forming and stuff like that. And maybe in this case, we just got some fence to remove. So I'm going to go ahead and just say fence only, and I'm just going to hit okay and close. And when I look at my estimate here, you know, there's all the things from that footing. There's that removed fence. So there's the only item that came over, because that was the only item I quantified. So that's what I think is great about it, is a lot of people's database has so much stuff in it that people find themselves looking, searching, trying to find the stuff they're looking for on a regular basis, even the same items that they use day in, day out. Let's put them in a shrink wrap. Let's put assembly together. Let's keep all those organized with each other, so that way it makes it easier to, easier and faster to find. So if I go back to that footing one I did, you know, I could sit there and say, oh, I've got some other footing here, and maybe the dimensions are a little bit different on it. So, you know, maybe I got 50 yards of that, and maybe I don't have a step in this one's case, and maybe there's only 100 square foot, and maybe I only need 100 linear foot of rebar, and maybe I only need 5 yards of concrete or whatever the case is, and, you know, same type of thing. Now, one of the things about this assembly is, even though this assembly is kind of weak because, well, that's only one scope. That only fits a small portion of our work. You know, there's a lot of time that we use different rebar sizes, and a lot of time the strength of concrete's different, and things like that, where it's just different every time. So even this lends itself for differences. So when I'm looking at this list, I could come in there and say, right click, substitute item. And that would let me pick another item from the database. And it starts me with being right in the same vicinity as where the first item was initially. So I could come back and say, oh, well, that this job's only going to be using number 4 bar, and maybe this job can get by with 3,000 PSI concrete. So the database still has, you know, number 5 bar in it. It still has 3,500. So if I pull this assembly up again or things like that, and I missed a question on the question board. Steve, I will actually go through that a little bit, because, yes, there was a question that came in that said, within one-time assemblies, can bid item location be saved? So in that assembly itself, no, but you can actually set those values before you pull the assembly up that would know those. So once we kind of go through the basic takeoff, I'm going to come back and show, you know, putting on WBS codes on these assemblies when I first pull them up. So we'll kind of hit it at that point there. As I'm looking through this list, it's also common that, oh, wait a second, I need something else. So maybe there's a keyway or anchor bolts or something else that I need in this particular case that wasn't in that assembly when I set it up. If I right-hand click and say add item, this just changed it, like I can do item takeoff. So if I come back here and I'm going to just say search, because I'm not sure where keyway is offhand. So let's say keyway and footing. So there I was able to pick it, and maybe I need, you know, what was the length of this turkey? 50 foot long. So maybe I've got, you know, another item. And there again, this item's not in the database. It won't be there for the next job. Now I could say save as assembly again and save this as assembly if this is, hey, this is a footing type 1 and this is a footing type 2, and I want to create some of these standardizations if there are, you know, hey, here's 3 different typical ones that we run into on a regular basis. You can go in and create those in the database, and then bang, I could just pull it up and it would have that different list of items for some reason. The other little secret here that a lot of people don't realize is you can also do one-time items from this screen. So I don't click on this one time because that'll take me somewhere else. Let's say that I've got this rebar in here. And let's say, I don't know, let's say for this job, there's some special sealer or epoxy or something I'm going to add to that rebar, or maybe I've got some sort of a special finish for the concrete. Let's do that instead. So let's say that I need to add color concrete, or maybe I need to add hot water or calcium or fly ash or whatever the case is, fiber mesh. If I look at this, it's going to tell me what phase it is. So I'm going to kind of cheat in this case. I'm going to say 3306. in this next column is usually where you put in the item numbers. So, you know, that was item C space 30 or whatever the case is. When you're doing a one-time item, this turns into what categories? Labor, material, equipment, sub, other. LM for labor and material, or, you know, M and E for material and equipment, or whatever the case is. So in this case here, since I'm saying that this is going to be an additive for the concrete, I'm just going to put the letter M in there for material, because I'm not going to have any additional labor charges with it. I'm just going to say there's some more material money for some reason. So in this case here, let's say I need some hot water, and it's going to be based on the same five cubic yards. So there again, I didn't have to go to a bunch of different places. So a lot of the time, I think it's critical when people are doing assemblies to really do as much as possible in that assembly, because that way I can still sit back and, oh shoot, I forgot this or I forgot that, and can still put multiple pieces together to come up with what I really need to for, you know, the picture on this thing. And you can sit there and do as many one-time items as you want. So I could say, you know, let me add another one. Let's add some more material. Let's say that I need to add, maybe that's per yard too. So, you know, these items won't have any prices. I can't save these back to the database right at this point, because these items are not necessarily in the database. So, you know, it would save all these items. It could, it really wouldn't have these. But if I went ahead and, you know, push this back to my estimate, once it's in my estimate, there is the option for, you know, one-time items. And this would actually allow me to save those one-time items back into the database. So that way I could, you know, hey, that's something we use on a regular basis. Let's get that saved in so I can use it again. So in this case here, I'm just going to hit OK, close. And if we look down through our list here, there was where I removed fence. So this is a list of all those items that I just put in. And there was my two one-time items. No money associated with them. So that's where I can now come back in and put in whatever pricing or productivities, if it was labor and labor money and all that good stuff associated with it. If I take a look at assemblies again, whoops, with the takeoff. Ultimately, once I get these one-time assemblies built, in my mind, that's where it then makes sense to come back and let's add some characteristics to it. Let's get some formulas in there. Let's get some choices so that way I can have a selection option to let me pick what strength, let me pick the rebar size and things like that, and make this assembly even more powerful so I don't have to do the right clicks and substitutes. I didn't have to come up and you know, come up with those formulas each time and so forth. So that's where that this kind of looks like then, is this is where some of them in this database are already pre-built. These are pretty basic, so I'm going to start with these and then swap to another database that has you know, some more mature ones to kind of show you what those might look like. So in this case here, if I go in and pick up a slab on grade, in this database they've got a slab on grade and they got ones that say digitize. And the main reason why they did this was, you know, back in the days that this thing was developed, you know, somebody was using a scale, they could say what's the length and what's the width and have it calculate the square footage. This one might be more for somebody that was using a digitizer or something like the e-takeoff, where I could just measure the square footage and then have it come back and you know, just have the assembly deal with the area. And I got a question here, so let me look at it a second. So we got a question that says, does adding one-time item stay with the assembly for the next time I use it? So no, like I mentioned there, if I go through and I did a one-time item down here, it would not. And even if I come back to the estimate and let's say that I save, because I'm already past the time of that assembly, these items here, you know, are not part of it. I could come back and actually go back to my database and say that I want to, that not lit up. Okay, probably in the middle, take off, that's part of it. Save one-time items to database. It's going to pull up a list of here's all the one-time items I've got in this estimate. It's going to come up and try to come up with a suggestion for where it wants to number it. So it's basically looked at the order and said 10, 20, 30, 40. So it's went to, you know, 70 and 80. But that's where I could come in here and say, well, shoot, I want these to be completely different because I have may have some more strength later. So maybe I want to say this is going to be 200. And this is going to be something like 210 or something of that nature. So, you know, if I went ahead and hit OK, both or update both of those would be in the database. I could then go back on like on my next job and pick those items from the database, or even right now I could go back and, you know, maybe modify that database and just add them. So matter of fact, that probably wouldn't be a bad idea. So let's just say update here. So if I did go up to database and went back to assemblies and found the one that we just wrote there a moment ago. So there's that footing assembly we just wrote with those items. I could say insert items and go pick more items from my list. So where was that at? That was concrete. That was 33. So there's the two new items that I just added there. So that way I could just pick them and that way drop them into my list. And now, yes, those would be available for the next future estimates and things like that. So that's the only thing that's a little awkward with one-time items is I can't do it all on the fly at that one time and so forth. I guess the other note would be that I'd probably recommend instead of doing that is let's say that I was using that assembly again and there's some other item that I need. So another thing to kind of keep in the back of your mind is if I did sit down and say, well, wait a second, there's a some other additive I need or something of that nature. Let's say I need to have a color concrete option or whatever. You know, I could come in here and say something like add item. That would take you to your database. So that way, this is where we could go be going through and looking at the different items and, you know, what they have and so forth. But this is also where I could take the extra 2 seconds to say, I want to edit an item. I want to add a new one to the database. I'm going to pre-fill an existing one to get me started. So maybe this is going to be 220 is going to be and then I can even deal with money if I wanted to. So I could say, well, that's going to be a, you know, $20 yard ad or whatever the case is. And, you know, now that is something that is in my database. That is something that if I dropped it down here, it would be here. And if I did come back and save that as an assembly, whatever I'm going to call it, let's say. So I'm going to just cancel that one. So now when I take a look at my list here, where did I just put it? Oh, I created it at one time. So I didn't pay attention to that. So in that case there, I've created it at one time. If I said add and pre-fill and stick it in the database, let's say that way I could get in my database too. So basically there's that new one and it's got my additives in it and things of that nature. So that's how you can kind of take that and kind of work it over and so forth. Okay, let's see. So we're gonna take a look at an assembly that has a little bit more to it. So let's go ahead and pull up one of these then. So this one's still pretty basic. So this one's only got a handful of questions. It only takes off a handful of items. So I could sit there and say, you know, I've got a 10,000 square foot slab. It's all going to be 4 inches. We're going to do 3,000 PSI concrete. You know, how many linear footage of edge forms or whatever the case is. And then once I go through there and answer those questions, you know, it can calculate some given list of items and things of that nature. So a very powerful way. And basically how I answered the strength of concrete, it actually swapped a different item into the estimate based on how you responded. So if I come back here and say that I got a, you know, 1,000 square foot, something that's 6 inches, and maybe we jump to 4,000 PSI, and maybe it's only some other linear footage and so forth. So that case, you'll find that it's picked up some 3,000 for my original one and some 4,000 PSI concrete for that particular line. So I can kind of see that in that mix. And when I say, okay, it'll just cast it out to the spreadsheet, just about like everything else. So, you know, down here at the bottom, there's those items I just added from that particular slab on grade that we just did. One of the advantages of assemblies is if I were to take a look at my estimate and look at it somehow by assembly, I can go back and actually review it. So in my case, I'm going to go back to my sequences. So this is where I can actually change my tabs. And in my case, somehow I've got two tabs that have the word location associated with them. So I'm just going to go to this one and change it because I shouldn't have two for the same reference probably. And let's just set up one for assembly. So now I've got a new tab down here at the bottom for assembly. here's all the stuff that I did with Takeoff that wasn't using assembly. So I'm just going to double click on it and close it. So there's that footing I did. There's that slab I did. There's that demo I did. So this is the one that had all the fancy, you know, calculations and things of that nature. So I'm going to go ahead and right hand click on that one and tell it I want to review that assembly. So in this one here's case, I can see pass one was 10,000 by 4 inches. Pass two that it looks like I did within the same minute was, you know, 1,000 by 6 inches. So my reviewability of assemblies are a lot greater, because now when somebody comes back and says, you know, did you take care of that addenda where they changed that 6-inch slab to an 8-inch slab or something of that nature, you know, I have some recourse to go back and kind of confirm what was those quantities that I put in this estimate and so forth. So let's say that for some reason, some sort of a change came out where this was the wrong depth. So I need to change it. So if I come in here, I can click on that number, change it, tell the system that I'm doing a replace. So that lets it know I'm doing a correction. So if I look at my audit trail, I've gained two more passes. So if I look here, this is saying replace by pass four. This is how I answered it when I did this at, you know, 1046. At 1048, I reversed it with a negative one quantity. So in that case, all that did is basically two and three net to zero. So it just kind of shows me, I don't know why, but it shows me the math of how it's backing it out. And then basically pass four is my replacement pass where it's put it back in at, you know, my 8 inches. So this is where it's a good idea to put some notes in here sometimes. So with these passes, I could click on this note and actually say, whatever. And something that simple can be critical. Like I've watched people where somebody will come in and ask them a question about an estimate of, you know, did you take care of this addenda and things of that nature. And, you know, one client, shoot, we went off on a half hour detour from our training to kind of go through there and look at his estimate and try to make sense out of it to see, you know, did he really take care of that in his changes and things like that, where, you know, in this case here, if I knew it affected this slab, maybe I could go into review mode. Maybe I could go down through here and look at my different passes and so forth. So maybe as I got to this one, I can actually see, you know, oh yeah, addenda one changed that slab from 6 to 8. Yes, I've got it taken care of, or something of that nature. No, that must have came out after, you know, we've done this job or whatever the case is. The passes can also be handy while you're doing takeoff. So if I wanted to basically just roll my numbers up, so I'm going to go back to assembly takeoff. And I'm going to go to a footing, let's say, and I'm going to go in and pick one of theirs that has some formulas with it. So I might come in here ahead of time, and I might say that I'm working on sheet one, detail one. Or I might also say, since it's a footing, it might be FTG1 if I wanted, or whatever the case is. So I could come in here and say that that might be 100 foot long by 2.5 foot wide. Let's give me 12 inches of concrete. Is it hand excavated? No. Is it formed? Yes. And maybe no steps. So there it came up and calculated something. And then I could come back into here and maybe I could say, and I don't know, maybe it's a little longer and wider. And let's say that I messed that up, because maybe since that's more like a grade beam, maybe I wouldn't want the footing formed on that. So I am going to hit undo. We'll like take the last pass out of the system. So this is all the same as what I had. So I'm just going to change this to a no and have it recalculate it. And that also dropped my note. So I'm going to go back in and put my note back in. Sheet one, footing one, 100 foot long. Sheet one, footing two, 200 foot long, you know, something of that nature that gives me a lot nicer reference to know where this came from. And that's one of the advantages when some people are using things like, you know, eTakeoff. So eTakeoff is where I can pull up PDF files, trace out dimensions and things of that nature, pass that through to my estimate. You can actually be highlighting something in your estimate and tell it where this come from for eTakeoff, and it will actually open up the project back up and actually show you that line highlighted. To just kind of confirm, yeah, this is where I came up with that lino footage for that footing, or or that square footage of slab or whatever I was measuring and so forth. If I look at this and I right click, I can also say view pass audit, sometimes handy. So that would show all my passes side by side. So as I look at each one of these, I can kind of tell, you know, one and two, and maybe I could look down through and see, you know, where some of the differences might be, or where this is probably more helpful in that mess that I had four passes on. So I might come back into this one and say review it. Go ahead and show me a view pass audit. So that way it could show me, you know, all four passes side by side. So that way I could kind of tell, oh, that was being replaced, so that's not in the system anymore. That's a reversal, so it's got a negative one. So those two cancel each other out, and maybe there's my good one. And then when I accept it and cast it back, you know, that's all going back to the spreadsheet. So now I'm actually going to change gears, and let's go into a database that has a little bit more content to it. And let's just say more stuff. Got some WBS codes that this estimate doesn't have. That's fine. I'm going to do it anyway. So if I take a look at assembly takeoff with this one, you know, these have a lot more detail to some of them. So, you know, this is more example of a pretty elaborate, you know, quite a few questions, quite a few items and so forth. So in this case here, you know, if I pull up this particular database, you can see that they've got just, 65 different things down into here. This person that's developed this, you know, has really went through some effort of, you know, here's all my concrete stuff, or here's all my concrete materials or my rebar materials and, you know, pumping. So they even threw in some bogus items here to just try to, you know, there's no money or dollars associated with this. They're more just trying to, you know, separate out the different thought process here a little bit. And then they also did the same thing in their questions in their case. So if, as I go down through here, you know, that line really don't do anything. It's more just to kind of let me know where I'm at in the process. So in my footing, maybe I've got a 100-foot long footing. It's 2.5 foot wide. Depth of concrete maybe is 1 foot deep. In this particular database, you know, they go through and ask about how you're going to do it, whether you're doing self-perform. Is it something you're going to sub out, things of that nature? So I'm going to say one, I'm going to do self-perform on it. What's my strength of concrete? How are you going to place it, or additives or things like that? So in this case here, maybe I'm using standard mix. Then they're going to get into some sort of additives and so forth. So if I want to say that, you know, maybe we need some hot water added to it. What type of placement, you know, no pumps needed. So it's going to do it right out of the chute. Maybe I need a, you know, pump truck or a crane or things of that nature. So in this case here, I could say, you know, three. So the thing I really like about some assemblies that different people have done is they force somebody to think about it. You know, how are you going to get that concrete to the site? How are you going to, you know, do this? Do you require this? Do we need that? So, you know, they can be a very powerful kind of a method to just kind of make sure that I'm getting the bases covered. Because I think that, you know, a lot of people can get so many interruptions that, you know, did I ever take care of this? And did I add this? Or you know, this was something we overlooked or whatever. So that's where I think this is powerful because, you know, just like in this case here, because I said I was pumping it, you know, is there going to be a pump up setup charge? Yes or no? So it just kind of forces me to think about different things that I could always sit there and say, no, if I didn't need it. So like in this case here, does the footing need to be formed? No. So maybe I go right on. But if I said yes, maybe it would come up then and ask me for how many uses I'm going to get out of those forms or, you know, whatever it's taught to do. This one's kind of different because it lets me do my rebar as pounds per yard or doing a detailed takeoff or things of that nature. So that way I could tell just how many pounds per yard. So I could sit there and say some number and be done with it. Or I could go down through here and ask the answer and, you know, hey, we're going to have two long bars and those are going to be number fives and you know, whether I need transition bars and top bars and whatever. So this is, you know, a lot more elaborate than that little one I did. So, you know, that little one I did, shoot, it's only got six items in it. It's probably only got six formulas. So, you know, I'd be surprised if it took someone over an hour to, you know, write all those formulas and so forth, where, you know, something like this, no, this one's probably got, you know, many hours on it to go that far. Then they have all the additives and you know, whether we need excavations and diggings and whatever the case is. And as I go through all these, eventually it's going to go through and calculate whatever of that 60 different line items are needed. And cast all those items back out to my estimate. So that way I could see my, you know, my boom truck, my cleanup, whatever the cases are. Questions, comments about assemblies? Does that make a little bit of sense? No. Okay, so last thing I want to do is talk about models a little bit. And then we'll get into WBS code. Let's go ahead and simplify this mess. So let's say what? Look at it. Highlight everything. Let's just start fresh. Okay, so the next thing I want to take a look at models. And models is basically the step above assemblies in my mind. So models can be used in primarily two cases. People that do a lot of monotonous detailed takeoff, they could be very powerful for. And for people that do conceptual estimating and things of that nature, is probably the two sweet spots that models come into play. If I go back to my other database problem. Got a couple set up in here. Let's see what I've got. So I've kind of set up in this database just a kind of example of each one. So what would it look like if I was doing detailed takeoff? What would it look like if I was doing conceptual? So what I mean by detailed takeoff is, you know, when we come back in a moment and we talk about, and maybe I should do that first. I am going to take a look at WBS codes a little bit first, because that way it'll help sync that models and why that models is so critical when we run through it. When I took all those items off, I was just throwing things to the spreadsheet, and I was kind of at the mercy of, you know, phase an item, takeoff order, maybe assembly, you know, maybe all those tabs made sense, but wasn't very good as far as if I really had footing one and footing two and wanted to see those separate or anything of that nature. So a lot of time people use WBS codes, locations, you know, the alternate function, things of that nature, so that way I can group content and basically repeat it over and over. So in this case here, let's say that I was taking something off that I had a footing and a slab and some of this different detail. So I'm gonna kind of run through and just do a estimate again, kind of using these default WBS codes. So I could tell it what building I'm working on and what location and things of that nature. So if I come in here and put in building A, and let's say detail is gonna be one. Now, in my case, this box typically when it pops up is somewhere just right here in the center of the screen. If I grab this and move it around, you'll see that these little things pop up at the side and the top and the bottom and so forth, that you can actually move the mouse to it, and it will actually allow you to lock it to that portion of the screen. So that way my estimate screen here got smaller because this is actually locked on so I could see it as I go through and do takeoff. So this is real handy in my mind, because that way I can see all these different values that I'm coding stuff out to as I'm throwing it out to the spreadsheet. So with that being said, if I kind of backtrack and I take a look at, like, you know, quick takeoff again, and I take off, don't really matter what, let's throw that same footing out there and whatever. Let's just do a search. Let's just find some fast. So let's say I need some of this and some of that, some of that, and some of that. So if we come on back to my spreadsheet here and we expand this thing back out, there's a, you know, handful of items that we just took off. If I were to sort it though, I could set up different tabs based on these different WBS codes to sort this thing out better. So I'm gonna go back to my sequence tab. And I'm going to say that I want to add a tab for building by detail by assembly. And maybe I'm going to add another one that's going to be by building by group base for the heck of it there. So now if I take a look at building one, or building A, had some footings. You know, here's all the footings that we had assigned. I didn't put any of them to an assembly, so that part doesn't necessarily show up. But that way I could kind of start to see some sort of grouping going on. So even with, you know, doing quick takeoff or item takeoff or things like that, this can be handy because that way I could sit there and just be doing takeoff, and it will help give me some sort of segregation in my estimate. So even if I said footing again and take off some very similar items with what we just did, I can start to see the difference between, you know, here's footing one, here's footing two, start to make sense out of it, because, you know, just trusting things to phase an item could be a very difficult way because all my like items are by each other. So, you know, if I end up having, you know, 100 yards here and 50 yards here, whatever the case is, you know, maybe those are the same strength. Maybe those are something I could say could buy an item and it would add, you know, all the like items together in the estimate or something like that. So I can get a grand quantity of yardage and so forth. But when it comes to reviewing, you know, it's going to make more sense to review this estimate kind of in the order that you build it. So that way I can actually look at it in some sort of chronological order or something of that nature, better than just how the phase and item does of how the database is organized. If I do something with assemblies, then same thing could take shape. So I'm going to go off to my takeoff again. I'm going to say, let's go back to footing one for a moment. And let's go to assembly. So I might come in here and I might say that I'm doing footing. So let's say this first one's going to be, let's say I've got something that's 200 by 100. And let's say I've also got something that's 100 by 100. Okay, so let's say this first structure might be 600 foot going around the edges, 2.5 foot wide, 12 inches deep, and let's say it's going to be formed. So that way, that just calculated my building A. And then maybe in this case here, maybe I'm going to go ahead and go to slab. Maybe we're going to take off the interior slab, and let's say it's going to be 20,000 square foot. Oops, that one's length and width. 200 foot by 100 foot at 4 inches. And then maybe I'm going to go to building B then. I'm going to look. I've already put in a footing one and two earlier, so to stay consistent, you know, I could come in there and change it up and so forth if I wanted to. In my case, I'm going to kind of come back and say that I forgot to build a footing. Let's see. No, I'm not going to building B. Let's say building B has a footing one. So let's say it's going to be 300 foot. What is that? 2.5 foot wide again, 12 inches deep. That looks fine. And maybe the other side of it is going to be a footing type two. So maybe this is going to be a 100 foot long by 3 foot wide by 36 inches deep that is not going to be dug. And then maybe I've got a slab. That's 100 by 100 by 4. Okay, so in this case here, you know, I'm kind of going through just the monotonous task of, you know, defining what I'm working on, go do some takeoff. Define where I'm working on, go do some takeoff. And some people like it because they can see all these values. Some people don't. So, you know, keep in mind that you can also hit this little pin and that'll unstick the pin. So that way, when it's laid down, it does like an auto hide. So it's still over here. It's still on. It's still my default values, but as I move off of it, goes away. So that's kind of your call of, you know, how you like to do that. I like to have it locked. And then when I'm done with it, I like to just kind of get it out of my way so I can just focus on my spreadsheet then. So in this case, I could tell building had some footing, it had a slab. Building B had some footing one and two, and then had a slab. So, you know, a lot easier to review if I've spent the time to really, you know, organize my estimate to get these different pieces right. Now, part of me says that's a very monotonous task a little bit, because I went to those default values, I put them in, I went and ran my assembly, I accepted my assembly, I went back in and answered my, change to the new detail, pulled it up. So, not complicated, but just a monotonous of kind of going back and forth through those sequences each time. I'm going to do something similar for at least the footings with, I think that's what that model had in it. So I'm going to go back to the model here and pull up this detail one. So it could have a model reference and it defaults to time and date. And at this moment, I'm just going to leave it alone because this example is not going to have anything. The next example, I'll go back and put something better in there. So what building am I working on? Building A. What detail am I working on? FTG one, footing one. What's the length of that footing? Well, the first one was, let's say the front side of both of them are going to be different. So let's say 400 foot here. Let's say it's going to be 2.5 feet wide. It's going to be 12 inches deep. Yes, I want to form it and I don't need any steps. Now, let's say that I've got a footing two, because this right now is going off to my slab. So before I leave here, I might go ahead and I might right click up here and say, add that assembly again. Not edit. Let's try the one that says add instead of edit. So now what it's done is it defaulted all my responses down here for how I did the first one. So there's my building A, footing one, blah, 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 blah. There's my building A. Let's say I had one side of the building that was odd here. So I'm going to say this has a footing two. And there's all my questions for it. So going around this other side, I'm going to say that it was 200 foot of 3 foot wide, 36 inches that is not formed. And then I might come down here and say, okay, well, I'm going to do some slab work. So maybe for that building A, I had S1 for slab one, and maybe it was 200 foot by 100 foot of 4 inch stuff. So in that case there, I've done everything for building A. Now I could keep saying insert assemblies and keep going if I wanted to. In this case, I'm going to say that buildings are maybe different enough that I'm going to separate mine. So I'm going to go ahead and say that this is really my building A stuff at the moment. So no calculations have been done. I can insert as many as I need to as I go through there. And I could just keep pulling it up and actually doing more new takeoffs. So I'm going to pull that thing back up and I'm going to say, maybe this one's going to focus on my building B content. So building B. Footing one. So maybe that was going to be 300 foot by 2.5 by 12. So the benefit to doing it all in one is it would actually default some of these values for me where I'm having to retype them. And maybe this had a different one. So I'm going to say add again. So this time here, I'm going to say that I've got a footing two. And let's say that it's got one side is 100 foot by 3 by 36 without that. And then let's say that here I've got some building A slab one. That's a 100 by 100. That's 4 inches. So the idea here is all I'm really doing when I do assemblies a lot of time is, gathering numbers and calculating quantities. So some people will sit there and look at what it generated and change them. And if I do a lot of that and substituting items and things like that, you're still probably better off to use assemblies. But if I'm just using a lot of assemblies the way they're set up, because they're so good with the questions that they ask and so forth, they lend themselves a lot for what I'm doing here, because that way I'm just going through the interview questions, answering them as fast as possible. When I say okay to accept it, it's out there. So if I look at my estimate at the moment, I'll see that I've got two things out here waiting to be generated. So these are ready to be generated. So if I just click the generate button, tell it to go off and do it, it's going to go through and calculate, my first one's going to have some items in it. So that way it's got footing twice, slab once, footing twice, slab once for each one of my buildings. And when I come back and look at my mess here, kind of the same look, other than I made it a little bit more complicated because I got two details of footings for my building A and B. So as I look down through there, just like I did with assemblies, the outcome looks exactly the same as long as I could do the similar job of labeling it. Now, the other benefit to assemblies that I think is very powerful is, let's say something came along and there's a revision or I need to go back and review something. So I'm going to say that this building B, that slab instead of 4 inches should have been 6 inches. So if I go back to Takeoff models, if I pull it up here, it would think I'm doing new takeoff. If I look at my estimate, it would show me all the different takeoff I've done. So in my case here, if I know it was building B that was modified, I could pull it back up and it will show me all the same response in the exact same order that I built them in this list. So I could come down through here and say, yep, the only thing that really got modified was this is 6 inches now. And if that was the case, I could just say, okay, to accept it, close it. I'm going to hit regenerate. So that way it'll regenerate that assembly. And that's basically modified my concrete quantities from that assembly. So that is using it in a detail case. So that way I could just go through and what's kind of nice about that is when I look at these default values, you know, I've got uniformats and location and alternates and things of that nature. When you get into developing your models, there is actually a little eye here for properties where I can go through and tell it, I want to be asked about the building and the detail. I did not want to deal with the location. I did not want to deal with those uniformat codes and things of that nature. So, you know, that's where I could kind of go through and teach the system. That's how come it knew, don't ask me all those other WBS codes or locations or things like that that I might have out there. It could go through and just say, here's the ones that you've turned on and just show me them. So very powerful. So that way I could just kind of focus on, you know, what someone needs in those questions. And I might just go back through and I'm going to use another model. I might just clean these out of the estimate right now. So they delete that whole thing. Questions with using models in detail takeoff, kind of a concept there before you jump ship to using the conceptual. Okay, so let's go ahead and think about more on the conceptual aspect then. If I look at models again, and I've got one here set up that's more conceptual. So this one here is very, very simplistic. But the neat thing about this one is this is going to estimate footing, slab, exterior wall, I think a roof system, you know, a handful of different things off of a given number of questions. So in this case, I'm saying it's very preliminary. You know, there may not be any drawings. I may not know any specs or anything of that nature. It's a very quick way of coming up with a standardized content of what my assumptions are and things of that nature. So in this case here, I'm gonna go down through and say, let's say option one, somebody would like to see what a 200 by 100 building is. So how many months of construction? I don't know. Let's say it's gonna take us 36 months of construction. Building was 200 by 100. The height of exterior walls are 14 footers. The number of exterior doors, I don't know, maybe we need 10 doors to get in that thing. Are we doing any interior work? Yeah, I'm going to do some interior work. So let's say that I need to have 600 linear foot of interior walls that are going to be 12 foot tall. Maybe I need 30 doors. And I must have been goofing off because I don't know that I need gold plated or silver plated doors in this model. So I'll leave those blank. So I'm going to say, okay, to accept it. I'm going to go ahead and close it down. I'm going to turn around and open it right back up so that way I could do another option. So maybe they want another option then. So option two is just going to be something that's 100 by 50. And let's say they're going to get this done in 12 months. And let's say that this 100 by 50, let's say the same 14 foot. And let's say I only need 10 doors. Let's say that I need sluster walls that are same height. And I don't know, some number of doors. So the concept here is I'm not going through hardly any detail. If I generate this, then I'm there again, I've got both options out there. They're both ready to be generated. So when I generate this, you'll see a lot more content go by in this bottom window. Because in this case here, I got superintendent, hook up the phones and temporary electricity and a assembly for a footing, an assembly for a slab, assembly for a wall, a metal deck or metal roofing, metal stud, exterior walls and interior walls, or, you know, some doors, you know, whatever it was taught to do. So if I go and close this down and see what this looks like, then this is where it probably makes sense to actually sort the estimate by model. And in this case, you know, I've kind of set up some locations. So, you know, I'm saying option one, you had some footings, some slab work, some exterior walls, the roof system. Maybe then once we got the roof on, then we came back to put some interior walls in it. Then maybe my general conditions is all at the bottom or whatever the case is. So, you know, there's all the content that I've got it taught at the moment just to do for this conceptual takeoff. So that way, very easily, I can go back and tell, you know, footings and slabs and walls and you know, very detailed takeoff, because that's the same assemblies that we used when we're just kind of going through, you know, assembly takeoff. So it's still taking off the same amount of detail, and it's still using the exact same item. So as you update your price for concrete or whatever the case is, the model could still be using that up-to-date item on it. As I start to collapse the money or collapse the detail, maybe I can start to see, you know, some of the grand totals for this thing. So, you know, I could tell that 200 by 200 is a lot more than the 100 by 50 is and so forth, whatever the different values are. Now, what I didn't mention about this, though, is you can still get to the detail if you need it. So I'm going to go back to one of those models. So I'm going to go back to my estimate. And let's say that this one, they want to do some variations of. So I'm going to go back and look at it. So there's how I answered all the questions. And yeah, I could just change these and regenerate it and so forth. But what I'm going to do, though, is I'm going to go down farther, because the way I've got this one set up is I've got all my cocktail napkin questions up here at the top. But maybe I generated this estimate and now, you know, we've got a chance to sit down with somebody and they've drawn up some drawings and have come up with, you know, a little bit more detail. So now that I know what they're building, you know, I think I assume probably 4 inches of concrete. So maybe I found out that, you know, they need to be a higher grade of concrete or higher strength of concrete and more depth to it and so forth. So as I go down through here, if I go down through and look at the detail, I can see calculated 52 weeks of superintendent. It's calculated one lump sum for hooking up a phone. It's calculated 12 months of my phone. It's calculated same thing for a lot of these, 12 months of electricity, 12 months of my phone, 12 months of my tool trailer. So here's where my footing starts to take shape. So, you know, some of these numbers were derived from up at the top. So if you think about my dimensions, I had a 50 by 100. So theoretically, if I add that together, maybe that would be 300 linear foot going around it for a perimeter. So basically in that case there, that's how it knew 300 foot. The rest of these questions were not from up above. So the rest of these questions were ones that I just put in ahead of time when I built it. So that's where I told it what the assumptions were. So that's a neat thing about a model is they are built on that same as if I was doing a hard bid, detail bid, a lot of questions. But what I'm doing is I'm kind of taking some of the edges off of, you know, I don't know what the depth of that is. I'm going to take an assumption. I don't know what this particular characteristic is. I'm going to take an assumption. So, you know, you can teach it a lot of things or tell it what those assumptions are, so I don't have to go through those questions each time and ask them. So in this case here, I'm going to go down and focus on my slab. So here was a slab. So in this case here, looks like I already had 6 inches in there. So maybe I'm going to say that they can get by with, let's say they had to go to 8 inches. And let's say that, you know, maybe they, for some reason, the footing has to be different. So I'm going to change it to something different for some reason. There's my slab, my exterior walls, what my assumptions were. So, you know, there again, perimeter was calculated. The height was asked from up above. My wall thickness, my stud spacing was all calculated. My number of studs, I don't remember how I did my number of studs. I may have just put 4 in there. Sometimes we'll write for like the corners are in. Sometimes we might just do something goofy where we might just say, you know, go ahead and take the perimeter and divide it by, you know, some number. So, hey, let's say every 10 foot, I'm going to have an extra stud or an extra handful of studs for where wall sections come into play or whatever the case is. So, you know, some people play games like that too. You know, what type of finish methods I had or how I'm going to hang it, you know, anchor bolts, all that type of stuff. My doors, my roof systems, you know, whatever it's taught to do. So since I made some modifications, we had this at 186. So I've got a little bit more money, probably in my footing, a little bit more money in my slab. So once I go back and hit generate again or regenerate this, then should go up a little bit more in cost. So it went from 186 to 190 then. So in that case there, it's got all my new slab, you know, yardage is a little bit higher, and my probably my yardage for this is a little bit higher since I changed dimensions of everything. So that's kind of where a model can be used. So it's just a method that I can go through there and kind of go from conceptual to detailed as I know more information. Now, some people could also run the model where maybe I know I'm getting into a detailed bid combination right off the bat, you know, just because it says conceptual, just because it's got these questions up here, I could come right down to here and actually start answering all these questions on my own too. So I could sit there and say, oh, I got a footing that's 100 foot long and 2.5 foot wide, and still come back here and say, yep, I want to add an assembly. So, you know, there's all my footing one and there's my footing two or whatever the case is, and those type of things. So it still lends itself for very detailed, especially for somebody that says, you know, we do a lot of metal buildings. So maybe there's a lot of very standardized, you know, components that we have, or we do a lot of schools where there's a lot of, you know, the concrete, the footings, the concrete walls or block walls or, you know, different things of that nature. So that way you can have some sort of content in there. So that's kind of the, what that looks like. Now, with kind of the question that you had asked earlier, Steve, was with, you know, within a one-time assembly, can the bid item and location and things like that been saved? And basically, no, we couldn't in a one-time. Also, when you build an assembly, even using assemblies don't really have defaults for those in the assemblies. But as you notice here with models, I did default these. So when I built this particular model, conceptual, come on down here to my detailed stuff, and here is that footing. For whatever reason, when I built this, I did say location, footings, or any of my other WBS codes. So if I want to say a building or detail or, you know, some of my unit format information or things like that. So with a model, yes, once you've got an assembly built, you could go back and drop them in a model and have some of these things, if they're just flat out always, this is a code I want that to get, kind of lends itself more for those defaults and so forth. Now, the other thing to keep in mind as far as defaults go also is, you know, in this case here, I haven't been putting any unit format information on. But this database, if I remember, does have some unit format content stored on the items themselves in the database. So the nice thing about that is I can look at this estimate by maybe my CSI divisions or things like that, but maybe I could also have a tab out there that's gonna say, that's the unit format level 1, 2, and 3, and let's see how much this database has or don't have. So in this database's case, you know, if I go ahead and collapse everything to begin with, there's all my structures. There's all my foundation, slab, general conditions, you know, so it's actually following the unit format value for as long as you had everything coded. So like in my case, it looks like I've got a lot of stuff in my database. It isn't necessarily coded yet, but that way, if you did have all the items coded ahead of time, just as fast as they hit the spreadsheet, they could already have some of these values kind of coming along for the ride. Questions with models, because that's a pretty new topic for a lot of people that I don't know that, you know, probably a smaller group of clients really utilize models very well. So is there any questions with models before we jump topic? Across the board there. So then the next thing I want to take a look at a little bit then is alternates are a feature that is fairly new. So it's amazing, you know, there's a lot of clients that went from the pervasive to the SQL, and and still kind of using a lot of the same things that they're used to and so forth. So the other thing I kind of want to sneak in here just a little bit was the alternates and how the alternates work a little bit, and then also kind of get into something basic that, you know, clients that have used the product for a lot might already have all their add-ons set up, but some other things that I'm finding that people don't realize that you can do with alternates and, you know, your add-on combination. So what I'm going to paint a picture of here a little bit is I want to go through and build something where I've got a base bid and, you know, a couple different alternates. And what I want to get into when I'm done with this is, you know, I want to be able to have a different profit percentage on these different pieces. Because now that we've actually got alternates built into the system, I'm finding more and more people are wanting to go through and say, you know, for alternate one, I don't want to use the same percentage as my base bid, or this deduction alternate, I don't want to give them any money back on that deduction alternate and some of those type of gains. So in my case, I'm going to go up to advanced. These are the main buttons I'm going to be focusing on, is everything in this little alternate section. So we're going to go to statuses, and I'm just going to set up a couple of very basic statuses. So I'm going to say include, exclude. This include tells it whether it's going to be in the grand total at the bottom of my estimate or not. So if I've got something that's included, it's going to be in the grand total. If I have something that's excluded or doesn't have that include check, it's not. Now, some people that follow a life of an estimate throughout the life cycle of it, you know, you might also create different ones in here called contract signed, and maybe that shows up, and maybe I've got a verbal okay, and maybe doesn't, you know, that's kind of your call and so forth. Yeah, maybe if it's an okay, maybe I'll say that's included in the total. Maybe I've got the some option was rejected or something of that nature, and maybe rejected isn't. So, you know, this is where you could potentially have multiple ones. Maybe I'm waiting for a response on one, and maybe it's not included yet either. You know, whatever your method of your madness is of how far you want to go. And for right now, I'm just going to leave those out there, but I'm going to use a couple of them. So then I'm going to set up my alternate. So in this case here, now keep in mind, you can also import these. So if you're getting these options from somebody in like an Excel spreadsheet, or someone saying, hey, I want you to bid me this is my details. You know, keep in mind, you can import this. I'm not going to go through the import today, but there are two YouTube videos on importing alternates and things like that, where I go through very detailed and actually take some information off somebody else's, you know, website. Like they gave me a list of stuff in PDF and how to strip it and you know, how to import it and so forth. So in this case here, I'm going to hit add. And I'm just going to say base bid. And I'm going to say the base bid has, I put too many in there. There it is included. And let's say I've got the alternate. And I would assume everybody knows why I started alternate with the letter Z. Any guesses on that? Basically, it's just sorting. So alternate starts with the letter A. So theoretically, if I left that at just straight alternate, it would sort above base bid. So keep that in mind when you're building this. If you got some particular order that you like, you may have to, you know, kind of change the database around a little bit, or your titles around a little bit to get it in some order. And this is also where numbers would be really good. So, you know, if you weren't doing alternate 1, 2, 3, 4, you might do 10, 20, 30, 40 and put in some sort of descriptions if you had some chronological order or of how you want this content to be presented. Okay, so in this case here, I've got my base bid. I want an option for adding color concrete option to exclude at the moment for my grand total. And then I've got an option for the owner's going to provide gravel. So I'm going to say okay and accept it. And then I'm going to just go off and do some takeoff. So I'm going to go up to takeoff, and let's go to assembly, and let's go take off some slab. That have gravel? Concrete does. That got, I didn't look at that ahead of time. Is that got my, Some material money? No, that's just labor. It's a better one that had some rock in it. Oh, well, we'll add it. Let's see. So let's say that we've got something that's, I'm good with 10,000 square foot. And let's say it's 4 inches deep. Let's say it's 3,500 PSI concrete. And let's say it's got a couple hundred foot of edging. And then let's just come back into here. And let's say that I want to do a, list my items, and I want to do a search. Gravel for a slab is fine, and I'm not going to really think about it too much. Let's just say I had 100 yards of gravel to this. So in this case here, I kind of forgot before I did it, I should have went over here to my default values and actually put this for base bid. So that way, as I did the takeoff for that assembly, everything would already be coded to the base bid. In this example, since, oh shoot, I did the takeoff and I forgot about it, you know, if I start to now sort my estimate by alternate, so I don't see a tab down there yet to do that. And all these tabs are starting to clutter up mess. I'm going to go through and just remove a bunch of these. And let's say I'm going to add one for alternate. And maybe I'll add another one that is alternate by group phase. Okay, a lot cleaner there. So I could tell alternate unassigned because, you know, somebody when they did the takeoff forgot to hit the button and put it in ahead of time. So I've done this takeoff. It's all wrong. It's all to the wrong heading. So now I need to kind of flip it from unassigned to what I should have defined before I threw it in my estimate. So in this case here, I'm going to go through here and highlight them. And I'm going to do one of two things. I'm either going to go up to the move and copy up here at the top, or I'm going to right-hand click over here on the side and go to move and copy. So same thing. In this case, I'm going to use move because I want to move them from unassigned to what I should have put them to. I could say copy if it was something where I was want to make a copy of some takeoff. And when I pull up the list, this should have been part of my base bid. So that'll just go through there and flag this for base bid. So right now at the moment, if I take a look at where I'm at, I could see that I'm at $22,000 here for this total. The $22,000 is going to go through and say, you know, oh, I've got some sales tax and overheads and profits and things like that to put on here. So I don't know why I've got profit in there twice. I'm going to take one of those out just to check a bit. Sales tax, overhead, and profit. Sounds good. So I've got something in there. So I've got basically $26,000 worth of my estimate total right now. So that's where I could tell my $26,000 down there by the time I get all my add-ons in it. Let's say I'm going to do an add for color concrete. So I could then go up to my default values. Call it I'm going to be working on alternate one. Maybe I'm just going to do a quick one-time item because let's say that I don't have that in the database for whatever reason. So I'm going to say that that has something to do with slab on grade and how many yards did we have? I don't know. 1, 2, 3, 4. That's kind of interesting. Cubic yards. That's a material add. So there's my concrete line. Now this one looks a little bit different because the alternate was excluded. So because this is excluded, they've changed the font. So this font is supposed to look like a gray. I don't know how well that's coming over or not. It's also got a strike through it too that may or may not be, you know, available to see. If I go to options, this is where you can control the font. So I've got some people that say, you know, when they print it because of that gray, it makes it black on black with some printer, so that way it's not very legible. Or I've got some people that say that strike through makes it hard to read. So, you know, that's where you could go through the font and say, well, I don't like that strike through and let's turn it off. And, you know, then you'll kind of see over here, it didn't do the strike through it either. So you can kind of control whether or not you want that or how you want to flag it. So that way you can see it or what color you want it. If I come back to here and let's say that that's going to add $30 a yard to my concrete, the color concrete option. So I could tell $30 by my 123 yards is going to give me, you know, some dollar amount. But you'll also notice my grand total didn't change. Now, we may not have been watching that close enough, so I'm going to actually put my concrete in here at zero at the moment. And you notice that my total estimate at the moment is still that same right down to the 24 cents. So whether I had this line in here or not, because this line is excluded at the moment from the total, that's where it doesn't show up. So when I look at my total page, nothing about that line shows up in this total page at the moment. I'm going to add my other alternate and then we'll play some other games with it. So my other alternate was the owner was going to provide the gravel. So here's my gravel here. I've got a little bit of labor to place it. I got a little bit of material for the cost of the material. So in this case, I'm going to just actually do a copy of that. So I'm going to say I want to do a move copy. I'm going to copy that item. So there's another one just like it under owner to provide gravel. So now here's my owner to provide gravel, my alternate two, my gravel at slab. Here's my quantity. Because this is a deduct, personally, I want to see this as negative numbers. So if there was multiple items, you could highlight multiple items and right click and adjust, and it would adjust all of them. Or you could go through there and, you know, pick just what items you want to adjust. So in this case, I've only got one. So I'm going to right click on it. I'm going to say I want to adjust that column. And in my case, I'm going to cheat and I'm going to say multiply by -1. And that would go through and just reverse all the signs automatically of whatever I had highlighted. So in this case here, it's now showing up as negative money in my estimate. And in this case here, I'm also going to say that, well, if the owner's going to provide it, I don't necessarily need to give him a credit back on the labor to place it because I'm still going to have to place it maybe. So I'm going to go ahead and take the money out of there. So that way I've just got the material being credited back. Same to game. I'm still to the same 24 cents, the same pennies. That total is still exactly the same because that's something else that's just excluded. So as I come into here now and look under advanced again, this show excluded alternates. If you uncheck that, it actually shows you just what makes up that number. So if I'm not showing the excluded stuff, the only thing I've got included right now is just the base bid. That's all I see. If I check that box, then it's going to show me the included and excluded, though the total estimate only shows me the included. This summary button is what will show me all of it. So this is where I can see, here's my base bid, $26,000, the same as what this is at the moment. Here's my alternate one, my alternate two. This is an add for concrete. This is a deduct for owner to provide the gravel and so forth. So that way I can see it. Now at this moment, I don't see any add-ons because at this moment I've got all my add-ons set up to allocate. So in my case, I am going to take a step back and I'm going to unallocate all my add-ons. Now when I look at the summary, it will show me all my costs and the add-ons that are not allocatable. So you could say, okay, keep sales tax allocated, but show me the overhead and profit or whatever the case is. That way you kind of change that up as you see fit and so forth. Now, my problem with this is I notice that sales tax, what's it being applied to? Profit, overhead, what's it being applied to? So in this case here, I'm actually giving them some money back on my overhead and my profit for that deduct. So instead of the $1,300 cost that they're really going to be saving on materials, you know, I'm really getting a $1,700 cost back because I'm giving them money back on the profit. So that's where some people would say, no, we don't do that. I don't want to give them that money back. And that's one of the reasons why some people do multiple estimates. So that way they can have a separate set of total pages and add-ons. And there's supposed to be a future update where they're going to work on even better than what I'm going to show you here. But for right now, the way that I take care of that is I'd set up a different profit line for what it's going to be based on. So in my example here, I'm going to set up one profit for my base bid because I want to put 8% on my base. I want to put 12% on my alternate one, and my alternate two, I don't want to put anything on. So in this case here, I'm going to go back and say, I'm going to get rid of that profit line out of here altogether. Now, technically, I might want to put it in the database so that way I could reuse it over and over. In this case, I'm just going to do something quick for this shot. So I'm just going to do some one-time assemblies here, one-time add-ons. So let's say this is going to be profit on base. I'm going to say I want it on a category. Now, one of the tricks when I'm doing this is a lot of people might have profit on the total of the estimate. And when you do it on the total, it's only doing it on, everything. So it's got to do it on everything, and I can't distinguish between one and the other. So that's probably one of the major differences of what I'm doing here is when I say category, even though this has a range on total, this range does not do diddly. I don't know why they just don't flat out take it off somehow, but right now, if I do something based on a total of the estimate, this range is worthless. It's just doing it on the totals. If I say category, then I could go through here and say, I could check what categories I want and so forth. And I can go through here and let's say that I want a range. I want to put it on an alternate. And of course, I made that two words. So let's see if I can get that spelled the same. So it looks like it's base, base, bid. Base, base, bid. So what this range will do is this range is only going to do that one section. And I said that it was going to be 8%, I think. And then let's go through and I'm going to say that I want to add another one. So let's say insert add-on there. Whoops, I don't want to insert. I want to do it one time again. And let's say that this is going to be what profit on alternate one. And I want it on category again. I want it on all the categories. I want to put it in at 12%. And I want to say my range is on alternates. Now, if I had a bunch of alternates spelled consistently, and I put that as Z, so it's really Z, A-L-T, 1. I could do things like ranges. So, you know, maybe if I had alternate 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5 all get this 12%, but 6 and 7 do not, you know, that's where I could go through there and do, you know, start at alternate 1 through to alternate 5 and you know, cover more than one. So if I had 10 alternates, I may not have to set up, you know, 10 different profit lines for it and things like that. In my case, I'm going to say something like that then. So now if I come back and look at this, you'll notice that because this is excluded, you know, I don't really see any money here. So it's hard to confirm whether I really get what I want or not yet. So I'm going to go back and look at my summary because my summary should look a little different now. So now in my summary, it should show sales tax is still on what it needs to. I still have overhead in there, so I'm still getting overhead on everything. So you'll notice profit on base is only on my base number. Profit on my alternate is only on my alternate number. And this turkey over here didn't get anything. So in that case there, okay, I'm giving him a little bit of money back on my overhead at the moment, but I'm not really getting him, anything else. And, you know, if I run to do this, I might do the same thing with overhead too, if I really wanted to kind of keep those two segregated and so forth. A question that came up here was, what about bonds? So with a bond is still going to calculate across everything. So it's not like I could put a bond on just one portion or not. So if I go back to my total page here and look, so even on a deduct, I would probably end up having to give them money back on a bond because a bond is calculated as a percentage type of a number. So if I said insert add-on and yeah, there's my bond. So that's going to calculate something right now. And as I go back and look at my summary, I must have it allocated. This is also a good case of keeping in mind about your quick task bar. So because I'm finding myself jumping back and forth between these a lot, I might want to go ahead and hit say, okay, add that to my quick task bar. So that's that button there. And then I might come over here and say, oh, now that one already is, I guess if I just knew where to look for it. Is that one? That must be it right there. Yeah, totals. So that would take me to my summary. And that one would take me to my total page. So I need to unallocate that turkey so I can see the money. Now, if I look at this, you can kind of tell add, deduct. So bonds are a little bit trickier. I guess if you really wanted to play the game of not giving them money back on a bond or something like that, you know, I would probably have to do something where I don't know what think about that. Mathematically, it probably wouldn't come out exactly right. Everything here. And let's say that's going to be based on an alternate of ZALT2. And let's say that I'm going to go ahead and say okay there. Let's say negative 2%. So I could play some sort of a game where, in this case here, I went ahead and threw a little bit more money on there to try to compensate for those. So like in this case here, you know, I took $61 off of here. I took $22 off of here. So theoretically, maybe I'm taking off 60, 70, 80, 83-ish. So if I go ahead and said, you know, maybe 3%. No, we're close yet. Let's jump a little bit higher. Let's say 5. Okay, so there at least I'm a little bit over. So in that case there, I'm kind of canceling out the credit that I would be giving them. So that way they'd only be, why does that not look right still? Oh, probably because I'm putting a little bit more money back. I've got equipment in there too that I didn't really want to have in there. Let's say I don't really want any equipment because I'm not giving it back on the equipment stuff. Yeah, that's pretty close. So that way I'm just a little bit different there. So, you know, you can play games like that, but that's probably one thing to just kind of watch for a little bit. And theoretically, it's probably not necessarily a problem to give them profit back or the bond back, because theoretically your bond will be a lesser rate if the contract amount was really down by that and so forth. And that's really a little bit about, you know, kind of how the alternates work a little bit, and then also how to get into a little bit more elaborate ranges on my add-ons, so that way I can just play different games. So, you know, this doesn't have to be used for base bid and alternates. I might go off and use it for, you know, maybe floor two. You know, it's going to take more time to get all the materials up to floor two. So maybe anything about my labor that has to do with floor two, I want to put 1% on to, you know, put some escalation for that other floor over the ground floor, or, you know, those type of games. Or maybe I know, you know, I've got one client that they'll look at the bidders list and see who's bidding against them. And they know that there's certain trades that they self-perform that some of their competition doesn't. So their anticipation is a subcontractor bids an estimate, they add some percentage on it, then they give it to the generals that they're bidding against and they add a percentage on top of it. So they kind of feel that if it's a section that they self-perform themselves, there's a little bit more than my standard percentage I can get by with that, if I don't see, you know, other competition that bids the same, you know, scope type of thing. So I've got some people that will go in and say, okay, just things in Division 9 is going to be, you know, an extra 5% on because of who's bidding against me. And I know I can get by with that since we self-perform it or whatever the case is. So those ranges can be used for a lot of those different things. As I'm looking through this list, you'll notice that this is what my estimate total is at the moment. That's what's included. So I could come in here and say, yep, they decided to add the color concrete. So now in this case here, you know, I got $4,600 plus my $26,000 and so forth. So now I've got, you know, $3,100 for the estimate total. Back here in the estimate, you'll notice that it's all white except for the one that's still being excluded. So it's pretty easy to come in there and just change the statuses of, you know, maybe I've got a verbal okay, we don't have that signed contract yet. So because I said verbal was okay, that's still showing up in the base bid. You know, those type of games. Or maybe this was something that they've actually No, flat out already gave us the sign saying, no, they don't want it, reject it. So just kind of get it out of the numbers and so forth. Questions, comments, thoughts on anything there? Quick flashback back here. Have covered. Oh, I was going to talk more about the spreadsheet. Let's see. Any question about what we talked about there? I don't see anything on the board, so let's talk a little bit about the spreadsheet then. So the last couple things I had was just more about the spreadsheet and functions within and so forth. So we already talked a little bit about, you know, these chain sequences. So these were a method that you could go through there and tell it how you want to sort. So, you know, even how I did here, I've got base bid and alternate one and alternate two. You know, if I wanted to go through and sort this out some reason for, you know, a little miniature schedule values for each bid, you know, I could collapse it and basically come in here and see almost like a little miniature schedule value for every, you know, whatever heading I had and so forth. So you can really get in there and kind of change these sorts around, because the nice thing about it is I'm not messing around with formulas. I can't knock these out to come up with spreadsheets that don't add up. So it makes it very powerful when you get into coming out with just different requests, different combinations of dollars being put together and so forth. One of the things that I wanted to kind of talk a little bit about, because I still see too many people that get confused with it, is the spreadsheet layouts are still kind of confusing some people, and kind of how they determine whether there's holes in their estimate and some of those type of things. So I'm looking at my estimate here, and I'm going to throw in one item that I know is just flat out, let's see, I'm looking at this layout and I'm looking through here, and maybe there's different columns that I don't want. So, you know, keep in mind that you can come in here and I can hide columns. So I can kind of go through there and turn things off. You could also come back and say insert columns, so that way you can come back and actually turn on columns. So that gives me a list of all the different columns in the system. So let's say for some reason I'm doing all these quantities manually, and maybe I'd like to keep a note of how I came up with these quantities so I could go back and review it later. So, you know, I work with a couple of clients that they might go into here and they might say insert, and let's say I want to see the note column. And when I say insert, it's going to put the note column where I was at here. So, you know, maybe when they go through here and do something, you know, they might say that was a 100 by something, you know, whatever their logic was of what they came up with that, or a note about, you know, this was just doing the east side and west side together, or, you know, different variations. So that way they can kind of be adding different notes as they're labeling things. As you're doing any little changes like this, do you want to see that in the future or not? So as I go through there and I change anything at all, as far as hiding a column, inserting a column, changing the width of the column or things like that, it will actually come up and add the word change in front of it. So in this first example, I'm going to say save as. I want to basically save this new one that I did here as a completely different name. And I'm going to leave it under personal, that just me, I see it. So that way there's no sense in others in the company seeing it and so forth. So then I'm going to come here to the layout and say trash. Apparently I've used trash because it's red. So I'm going to call this trash one. So now you notice that this says trash one. What happened to my description? I like to be able to see the description. So as I look at the descriptions and all this, if I change content, you'll notice this change. So even so much as a column with change, you have an option. I can hit save as and give it a different name, or I might just hit save, and save will just basically update that reference. Now, it will come up with one more question. If it was one of the default ones, it will come up with an additional question that says, you know, you're saving this as a standard layout. Everyone else is going to see that change. So that way you can kind of tell that you're going to affect other people and so forth. When I go to the dropdown, I can kind of see the different layouts and so forth. So when I built this, I could say I could sort by alternate, and I could see there's my title for that alternate, whatever. So if I come up here and I say, yep, I want to see that trash one view that we just built, I don't see that alternate heading. So one of the benefits that they've done with this layout is they've made it where you can look at the same layout between multiple tabs. The thing that's a little bit different that you've got to kind of master if you haven't already is I do have to tell it whether I want to see some of these columns when I start sorting by them. So for example, I could actually look at, I want to edit this. And here's all my columns and whether they're visible or not visible. So if you notice here, there's something here called alternate, visible. This line basically says it's going to show it up on every single line. This is considered the detail line. So if I say, okay, let's see what that means. So that means that on, why don't I see it? Oh, there it is, next to me. So as I look at this then, I could see every single item has that on it. And if I go to my other sort, I'll see that every single item has some code on it. So detail means that it's going to have it, so it's not the nice big heading up here, it's on every detail line. So the benefit to the detail line is it makes it easy to switch around. So if I decided for some reason these forms had to do with alternate one, you know, I could change that and it would automatically flip it down to that alternate one. So, you know, having it on the details sometimes handy, because that way you can kind of go down through line by line and find things and change them as you need to. So I could find something down here and say, well, shoot, that's not right. That should have went to the base bid, and flip it. And that way it'll go back and put it where it belongs up here. So the benefit there is every single line item has it. So whether I'm looking at it by, you know, phase and item or alternate, every sort can see it. If I say I don't want to see it on every single line item, over here is an option for something called spreadsheet grouping. So what these mean is if you're grouping by this value, show it. So when I look at this, it's not showing alternate. But if I go to something where I'm sorting by alternate, then it will show alternate for that title. So that's one of the things that gets, you know, I think some people are a little confused with the things like that, that, you know, oh, I built this masterpiece, but when I go to this other tab, I don't really see those columns that just like I used to, where I'd actually see the titles for those. So in a lot of cases, it's almost good to almost make everything groupable. So that way, no matter what you end up sorting by, it'll show you the heading. So that way, you know, if somebody happened to sort by vendor, I want to see that title. So I may not want to see it on every single item, but if I do sort by vendor, I want to see it, or all my different WBS codes. So, you know, if I used all these different uniformats, you know, if I happen to sort by uniformat, I want to see those titles, though I maybe don't want to see it on every line item. So that's where you can kind of control that. And like in this case here, since I'm not grouping by that at the moment, no harm, no foul, don't really show up. Expand and collapse, you know, I think most people already know some of that. You know, you've got the collapse where you can collapse things, you've got the expand where you can expand things and so forth. If I do just a heading, you can actually just do the headings. So this is kind of nice, like on bid day, some people will keep things collapsed, so I could just, you know, double click once, double click again, and actually get to a particular section without having to scroll through, you know, hundreds of items to get there and so forth. So especially when you're looking at it by divisions or something of that nature. So, you know, same type of thing. I've got everything collapsed, and you know, I could just kind of go down to a particular section and update stuff without scrolling, you know, pages of pages. If I look at help, and I look up shortcuts. Actually went to index. Under shortcuts is all sorts of different shortcuts. So especially for some of you out there that I know have used this product for some time and so forth, you know, if you're used to clicking on things, grabbing that mouse takes more time than just flat out keeping your hands on the keyboard and punching in numbers and things like that sometimes. So if you want to look up things like, I don't know, maybe keyboard equivalences, and maybe I want to see some different things about the spreadsheet. So, you know, there's just pages and pages of little goofy, you know, control this does that, control nine does this, or whatever the case is that, you know, can help navigate through different things faster that, you know, these are a little awkward because there's something that for those that use these, you know, there's somebody that estimate almost every day. There's somebody that, you know, memorizing that is no big deal because I do it so often, it's a no brainer. So as I go down through there, you know, one of the little basic things is just something like holding down my control key and hitting the letter S, you know, I'm into sub money now instantly. Control M, control L. Control right is extreme right, control left is extreme left, control top is, or up is extreme top, down is extreme bottom, some of those type of things for just navigating a little bit faster. Maybe something like your F4 key is your total page. So, you know, there's all sorts of little things like that that instead of me having to go back up and click on a particular toolbar or click on totals, you know, I could just hit the button and just do it. That's throw something else in this estimate. So here's some doors. And I've got mine set up. I think the default's like a pale blue or something like that, that I just have a hard time seeing. So, you know, the color is nice because it lets you know what items have no money. And if you go back into that same section we looked at earlier under file and options, you could come in there and you know, change your background colors or fonts around or things like that. This is also dangerous though to trust colors. So there's a lot of clients that I've asked through the years, you know, how do you know if you've got all the bucket, the holes filled in your estimate? And, oh, well, nothing's highlighted yet. Whatever color they've got set up. My problem with the color is if you so much as had any money in any other column, that's not highlighted anymore. So in that case there, you know, I've got a great big material hole waiting to get me in trouble, but it's not highlighted yellow because I at least have some money in that line. So make sure to keep in mind that scan estimate for holes will actually move the cursor to wherever the holes are. So right now I'm just clicking, 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 clicking. And in this case here, those are the only two holes I have so far in this estimate. But if I were to go through here and let's say that I was missing a quantity here, let's say I was missing a labor rate here, whatever the case is, you know, as I go through hitting the scan, you know, what's that quantity? What's the labor amount or material amount or equipment or what's that hourly rate that you took out and so forth. So, you know, that scan could be a very, very powerful way to try to make sure that you're getting some of these holes filled in so we don't leave anything, you know, any money on the table for just because I overlooked the line or something. So make sure to kind of work through that. The other thing that I've kind of been getting into is I've been working more, and you'll probably see some more videos coming out with, I'm trying to figure out now that all these estimates are in one database, I'm trying to figure out more methods of what would someone want to do with this data. So, you know, one of the clients I've been working with, we've kind of been playing around with something called Microsoft Power BI for reporting, where they can actually see a list of, here's all the estimates that they've been awarded ever that the estimating knows about. And here's how many contracts that is. And here's what the minimum and average contract size is or the largest contract they've got and so forth. And then maybe it separates it all by, you know, estimators and types of projects for each year, you know, that they've been working on. Same thing in this little grid kind of shows me the same thing as this project one, but it's more visual that I could see, you know, pretty much what's the biggest thing is that one there. So things kind of pop a little bit different. What regions, what's the list of the projects and so forth. So as I look at this and I say, retail stores in 2018, when I click on that, it will actually go back through and back calculate all these other ones. So for retail stores in 2018, I've been awarded about $4 million. There's been 10 contracts with a range of that dollar amount. So anywhere from $125,000 to, you know, $1.3 million. You know, this was the regions that it was in. And this was the list of what estimates made up that money. So these are the type of things that I think putting good, you know, labels in on those cover pages and things like that are going to be more critical. I'm also trying to do some that will start showing me like an average cost per square foot for different types of work and things like that. So one of the things that I've been recommending when people do Takeoff that, you know, you start kind of taking a look at a little bit more closer is, let's say that I did another one-time item. This will probably be where I'll wrap up. Let's say I got electric here and I've got one lump sum that is subbed. So I got my electric work here and I do my old control S. I go to the sub and I say that that's, you know, $50,000. For pricing it, there's no problem with that. But one of the things I'd probably recommend is put in some quantity, even if it's something as generic as a job size or something of that nature. Because if I could sit there and say, well, that was a 10,000 square foot building, and I come over here and say that that's $50,000, that will then tell me that it's $5 a square foot. And that way, when someone starts going back through, because of what I see with some of these reports that some clients are starting to get into is, you know, how can I tell for this type of work what that cost has been in the past, or what's the minimum, maximum, and average of what that cost has been in the past. So, you know, that little trick there will help out a lot for reporting if that's something that you can foresee in the future and so forth. So keep that in the back of your mind that, you know, it takes a little bit longer to put in a quantity instead of one lump sum, but theoretically that unit price is going to give me more in the future when somebody wants to start going back through and saying, okay, for zone one of this United States, you know, what do schools cost us? Or zone two of, you know, the Midwest here area here, what does that cost? And those type of things. And it looks like I've kind of missed some questions here too. One of the questions here that came up on the board was, can we highlight a row with a different color if I have a quantity entered? Can I have a row with a different color if I have a quantity entered than a color with no quantity entered? Yeah, so theoretically, if you don't have a quantity at all, it's just going to kind of fall back to that same thing as your that other dollar amount or that other font for $0 items. It's about the only one that you can control there right now. Now, what you could do is I have got some clients that, you know, maybe I can't do colors, but maybe I've got something in here and maybe I want to flag this different for whatever reason so I could come back and find these particular items differently. Or maybe they're items that I threw in bogus numbers that, you know, I threw something in there when I was where I was trying to get a preliminary number, but, you know, I'd like to be able to flag myself that this is a garbage number or something, you know, so that's where sometimes having different WBS codes out there. So if I looked at WBS, and let's just say, you know, whatever I'm going to call it, I'm just going to call it flag in this case. So if I had something where maybe I insert that column called flag, if I went down through there and said, okay, for some reason I want to keep that line separate and that line separate because I need to go back and look at them or something like that, I can't really flag them as a different color, but you could definitely make it where they would pop out and grab your attention. Because I could come back here and say, okay, I want to add another sort that's going to basically sort it by my flag first and then group phase and phase. So it still looks the same way as it used to. So now in this case here, I could kind of tell, there's the ones that I wanted to pop my attention on later to go back and look at and so forth, or for some reason. So I can't really do different colors on the different lines or because of, you know, one or the other. Now they are talking about letting us write formulas to do the different columns or things like that. So, you know, if that is critical, another thing to keep in the back of your mind is the estimating has really been, for something's changed where they've really been putting some development efforts towards the estimating product. So I would highly recommend to go to this submit product idea, and this will pull up what everybody's asking for. So this will actually give you a list of what people are asking for. You go to sign up the first time and tell it an email address and a password. They don't use the information for anything else, but then you can kind of come in here and actually see what other people are requesting, and you can actually click vote on if, oh yeah, I agree with that too, that'd be nice. Or you can also put in a search thing, and then if it's not there, you know, you could go ahead and tell it to add it, so that way other people could vote on that topic also. So right now today, what is the hot topic? Alternate space bridge not change, alternate summary page. Yeah, kind of they're talking about a separate summary page for alternate somehow. There's your highlight cell. So it looks like it is something that is, you know, got a lot of comment over it. So, you know, make sure to get in there and vote for it. So that way we can get the quantity up on higher on that, would probably be my best suggestion. Yeah, and that was on that too then. Okay, so I think that was it on the questions there. So at this point, I think I'm through what I wanted to kind of run through and probably a little bit more. Is there any other questions or comments? And with that being said, make sure, you know, mine's Kevin E at Bangard Inc., just like it's kind of spelled here, but with Kevin E for my name or coordinator, you know, either one, send off if you want help with anything, or if you have ideas for, you know, what would help you for additional content. We may be doing the content on, you know, live sessions like this. These sessions are also getting recorded and put up on YouTube and so forth also. So make sure to go off to our YouTube channel and subscribe to it. So that way you can get notification, because we're supposed to be, you know, we're going to have these classes on, I don't know, I'm doing about one a month on the web classes. And then we're also doing, once we get ramped up a little bit more, we're supposed to be doing about one a week on classes. There's also a Buildcast site that you can go to that actually is doing interviews with different companies and you know, not necessarily so much on the software, but just marketing things just like one of them was a topic about you know, construction estimating and kind of where it's been through the years by somebody that's been in it for many years and so forth. And then also, just like you got signed up for this class, you know, keep an eye out for the webinar classes, because I think we're ramping up more and more on more people doing you know, more of this content also. So if there's anything there that we can help out with, let us know. So if there's any other questions, make sure to unmute yourself and ask them, or throw them in the chat or question window. And that's pretty much the conclusion of what I had for today. I appreciate your time very much, and thank you for joining us today.